It has been so fun to hear from the students and from the parents about how impacting that camp was. And I really encourage you, if you do have students, get your kids involved in the youth group here. Brendan is amazing. He's our youth director. Just, he has such a heart for students. And when we have camp again, get them there. There's just something about when you just get kids away from their normal environment and put them in an environment of what it can be. It was awesome. There's a lot of great things happening here at Life Christian Church. We started our 21 days of prayer last night. It was awesome. Our house was overflowing, and God showed up in a powerful way, and it was a blast. Hopefully you guys can get involved with that. And Friday, we're going to come together on Friday night and have corporate prayer right here. And the Lord spoke to me about 21 days of prayer, that it is not a sacrifice. It is an opportunity to go to another level. So that's up to you to take that. So if you can't make it out to the homes just at 7 o'clock, wherever you are, just start praying with us. And we have a bunch of resources on our prayer resource site to help you in this time of prayer. All right, so before we get into the message, I just want to welcome those who are watching online, whether or on video. So grateful that we can be together. Today we're going to be learning and teaching on the Holy Spirit. The name of the series is called The Holy Spirit Revealed. So let's say together, today I will hear the voice of God through the Word of God. My eyes will be enlightened, and I will be changed. Now turn to your neighbor and say, I will be changed. Turn to another neighbor and say, I will be changed. All right. All right. So do any of you have a relative, an uncle, Bob, and Aunt Mary, a cousin Joey, just a relative that when you gather for different family occasions, maybe a holiday, a special holiday, in your mind you're thinking, I really hope Uncle Bob doesn't show. I have a few hands, right? Yeah. You know, just a little awkward. They say inappropriate things at the wrong time. Do you know what I'm talking about? You have that, you see that person, and they'll say something, or maybe they'll pass gas, whatever it is, and all of a sudden, you know, you kind of go, like, so you're related, it's a little awkward, they're a little goofy, you don't understand them, so you kind of like, let me just put you over here. And I think that's what we do with the Holy Spirit. I think that we've heard some things about the Holy Spirit. We've seen some things about the Holy Spirit. I know I did. I saw some things about the Holy Spirit, and so when someone told me about, tried to explain the Holy Spirit to me, I was like, no, get away from me, that's weird, because I saw and experienced things, now hear me, that were very different than what the Bible says, because he's not awkward, he's not weird in the Bible. It's what man has done with the Holy Spirit. So what we want to do through this series is really reveal him. And, you know, for some of you, maybe things that you've heard for many of you, I had one family that was visiting from the UK that had never heard the Holy Spirit explained the way we did this morning, and she was very grateful for that. And she talked like this. It was wonderful. I just keep speaking. Oh, I also want to say this, that last week for our baptism Sunday, we had just under 40 people baptized in water baptized. It was awesome. It was just great. Just great. And my husband was saying we have a similar amount of people at our first service 5 years ago as we baptized, which is kind of neat, right? So, all right. So the Holy Spirit revealed, and I thought we'd go right back to the very beginning when he's first talked about in Genesis. And most of us know him as the third part of the Trinity. You have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You know, in my mind, he should have been called God the Daughter, but no, it's called God the Holy Spirit. So, and you think about three, they say he's three in one, and sometimes we have a difficult time wrapping our brain around that concept. And for me, what helps me is I think about even our bodies and our souls and our minds. We actually have a spirit. The real you is a spirit. So when you actually leave this earth, you know, your spirit lives forever. We possess a soul. And our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions. Okay, we get that? But then we have a physical body. Three in one. Different functions, but they're all the same. But they're different functions, right? So, and there's things about God, obviously, that you're not going to understand. Like, I remember my daughter asking me, well, who made God? I don't know. You know what I mean? Or different questions. If you could understand everything there is to understand about God, my husband often would say this to me, then God is too small. So there's things called just faith, just trusting. And things of the spirit, the scripture says they have to be spiritually appraised. You're not always going to understand them with your natural mind. So in the very beginning, we see God talking or God revealing a little bit of the Holy Spirit. So Genesis chapter 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. I believe he was waiting for some instructions. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. Now, the Holy Spirit is like the action or the activity of the Trinity. So how were all three utilized in creation? The best example that I heard many years ago, if you could just picture this, God gave the command, let there be light. Jesus went over to the light switch, and he flicked it, and then the Holy Spirit was that power, that action, that activity that happened. Three working together. We know in Genesis chapter 1, I think it's around verse 26, the scripture says that it says, let us make man in our image. Let us. There's the Trinity again. All three working together to accomplish the task. But not only is he this action and this power, he's a real person. What makes him a real person? It goes back to when the Bible says that we are made in the image and likeness of God. The image and likeness of God, it's not our physical body, because we know that the scripture says that Jesus took on flesh and blood. So what makes us in the image and likeness of God, it's our mind, will, and our emotions, our soul and our spirit, because God is spirit. So we're going to see that the Holy Spirit has a spirit, soul, and body as well. So Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, it says, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground. Now picture again, God said, let there be man, or let's make man. And then Jesus began to move his hands. This is like my rendition of it. And then you've got the Holy Spirit, the activity, bringing this thing all together. Let's make man of the dust of the ground. And watch this. And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. What was the breath of life? It was God himself. It was the Holy Spirit literally being part of God, being breathed into this shell that was just there. And the scripture says he became a living being. Once God breathed life, the very breath of God, the life of God, the Holy Spirit into this man, that word being is referencing the soul, the mind, the will, and the emotions. He became a living being. So the Holy Spirit, since we have a mind, will, and emotions, so does the Holy Spirit. We're not going to go there, but I'm going to reference a couple of scriptures, and they're actually in your worship guide notes. And for those of you who are with us today for the first time, in your worship guide, there's some notes if you want to follow along. If you'd like to doodle and write any thoughts down, you have that for you. So the mind, it says in Romans chapter 8, verse 27, it says that God searches the heart of man and knows the mind of the Spirit. So the Holy Spirit has a mind. Then in Acts chapter 16, the scripture talks about how the Holy Spirit forbid the apostle Paul to go preach in Asia. So to forbid, he was exerting his will. And then we have in Ephesians chapter 4, it talks about how we can actually grieve the Holy Spirit. There's that emotion there. Think about all of the fruits of the Spirit. There's those emotions. So he's the Holy Spirit. He's a real person. Mind, will, and emotions were made in the image and likeness of God. So it was, now, the title of this message is He Made Me Divine. He made me, in fact, I want you to do this. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, did you know he made me divine? I'm just looking to see if you guys actually do this. Okay, turn to someone else and say, did you know he made me divine? One of you is sitting next to some hot babe and you're going, yeah, he sure did. What makes us divine is that the Holy Spirit entered that human being. Now, deity and humanity, they're not the same, but they're compatible. They're compatible, obviously, because he dwells in us and he is a deity. So now, being that the Holy Spirit came into that human being, it gave man this potential to see and to operate from God's perspective. So I want to talk a little bit about the soul of this man. His mind, this is prior to his fall, his mind was completely one with God. That's what was influencing him. It was God's voice, God's ways completely influencing his mind. His will was completely submitted to God. And his emotions were at complete peace. His emotions were not leading. I could use some of that, right? And his body was completely immortal. It was not corruptible. It was strong. It was healthy. It was immortal. That was prior to the fall. And watch this. All of the parts of man, they were operating in complete synergy. And in your next fill-in is right here. All the parts of man were in complete unity. They were led by the Holy Spirit. And watch this, driven by love, compelled by love. That was this divine human being that God created. Now, after the fall, so we know, that according to the scriptures, when man chose to listen to the voice of the devil instead of listening to God or disobey God, at that point, sin entered the earth and entered the human being. And when sin entered the human being, creating a sin nature, what left the human being was the Holy Spirit. Man is a spirit, but that Holy Spirit that was one, completely united to the human spirit, literally left that human being. And that's where we get that terminology, separated from God. We got separated because the Holy Spirit, the divine one, actually left the human spirit, because it's the Holy Spirit living in man that made him divine. So him leaving created a different creature, a completely different creature. And so now this is where man's left. In your next slide, the mind now of man, no longer was it being influenced by God and one with God. Now it had a new influence, the world around him, which was totally manipulated by the enemy. Jesus even said the God of this world blinds the sons of disobedience. So now the mind became one with its new influence. The will of man, it was all about me. Me, 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 me. And you're all looking at me like, that's not you. Come on, we wake up in the morning, all we think about is me. Right? Okay, and then the emotions, no longer peace, it was chaos. Chaos. You know, we have our good days and we have our bad days. And when we have our bad days, our emotions are in chaos, right? So, and then the body, it was mortal. It was very strong in pulling for sensation and comfort. So, and it, you know, I was thinking about all these three were kind of like pulling for themselves, each pulling one of the other, and the emotions were actually leading. So now we're left with that there's chaos instead of unity. We're led by the senses and driven by fear, a complete change. Now, that didn't happen overnight with Adam. It was a gradual thing that humanity turned into the place that he is today, which is so different than what God created. So, as I said, the Holy Spirit that left humanity, that Holy Spirit is what made him divine. And I thought about this. If you ever, you know, I don't know how to say this, but the two X's and then you have the Y and the X. The two X's determines the female, and the Y and the X determine the male. One letter makes us completely different. One letter. And I've heard my husband say this. I'm so glad it was a Y. How dare you? But so anyways, so it really, and we really are different. We men and women are extremely different. And I don't know why we're trying so hard to be the same, because we're not. I've had several ladies get very frustrated. You know, he just doesn't understand me. He just doesn't get me. And I'm telling you that the day I became free is when I finally settled, he won't get me. He's not going to understand me. I'm wired completely different. He thinks I'm crazy. Right? Yes, I'm getting a yes. Yes, TJ, I get it. Well, you know, Angie is a little crazy though, so. So, but, you know, he's not going to understand me and I'm not going to understand him. And I said this in first service, I don't understand this whole thing that my husband does in the fall, that he climbs up in a tree and it's absolutely freezing out and he sits there for 6 hours and looks at deer. I don't get it. Don't get it. Right? So we have, yeah, someone's like, yes. And you know, yeah, hunting season's coming somewhere in around November or so. So then we won't understand each other again. But the point is we're different. We're different. We're completely different. And I want you to get something. They weren't the same creature. The one who died spiritually was a different creature than the one that God created. And God, the whole journey of the Old Testament is to bring man right back to where he started in that garden. So now man is in this separation. And I said this in the first service that God can't cohabitate with sin. It's not that he doesn't want to, he just can't. And the example that has helped me is if you think about the sun, it's so powerful. And anything that gets close to the sun gets blown up because the molecular structure, it can't handle what's coming off of that sun. And it's God, when he gets around sin, it just gets destroyed. If I wanted to just designate or detonate a bomb in the corner of my house, maybe there's a corner of my house that I just don't like and I want to just bomb that one corner. Is that even possible? Generally, if you bomb your house, you bomb the whole thing, right? And that's the same thing with sin. It literally, when it gets with God, it just, it can't cohabitate. So God has an issue. A huge issue, because he loves his creation. Listen, the reason why he made humanity is he wanted to express love and be given love. That's why he made us. He wanted a family. You know, we have our kids, for those of you who are parents, you know it's going to be difficult. You know you're going to want to slap them upside the head one day, but yet we still have them. Right? And keep having them. I know. You know, I had a really hard first child. Anybody have a hard first child? I mean, and really, she's the reason why I actually wrote the parenting program. She is. You think I'm kidding. She's the reason why I wrote it. We called her the She-Man because she had the emotions of a woman, but boy, she had the strong tendencies of that driven, going to make it happen of a man. It was hard. I didn't sleep my first year. So even though we know that our kids, you know, we're going to have issues with them, we still keep having them. There's a love that compels us. And God just wanted a creation to love and be loved. And now he's in a dilemma. He can't hang out with his family. He has a separation. And his whole goal was, I got to get rid of that separation because I want my kids. I want to be with them. I want to be family. I want to experience the unity and the love that I had when I created man. So we have the second divine man, because Adam was divine. And the Bible calls Jesus the second Adam. I call him the second divine man. Now, a divine man, not a sinful man, a divine man sinned or committed a crime. Now, we understand our legal system, so you got to pay, right? You know, you can't say, I can't run someone over and say, I want Aunt Millie to pay for that. No, I'm going to have to deal with that, right? So a divine man sinned. A divine man had to pay for that penalty, for that crime. And the only divine man was Jesus. Jesus willingly took on flesh and blood. Became just as Adam was in the garden. The way Adam was is how Jesus was, but in the earth. He came, went on the cross, bore that sin, took care of that issue that was separating man from God that stood in the way of you and I being able to leave this earth and eventually spend eternity with God. Had Jesus not done what he did, we would have forever, for all eternity, been separated, even going to hell. And Jesus experienced hell on our behalf. And in Psalm chapter 16, verse 8, it says, it's a prophetic utterance of what was going to happen to Jesus. And it says, I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he's right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. Watch this. My heart rests in safety, for you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. You will show me the way of life. He experienced it on our behalf. He paid the penalty on our behalf. Why? Because he loved us. Loved us so deeply. And the scripture says in Romans 3:25, that God, in his forbearance, he withheld that punishment. All of the sins that were committed, that were supposed to be punished, in his forbearance, he held them back. And in one full swoop, put all that judgment right on Jesus. Now, I don't know how, I don't know where, I don't understand the whole thing. I just know he did it. And he did it because he loved me, because he loved you. And he wanted us back. What compelled him? What was it that caused God to see his son so brutally beaten? What was it that he had to actually turn his face and be separated from him? What was it? You! He was compelled by an overwhelming love for you. Because he wanted us back. And only the Holy Spirit, only he can reveal that kind of love that God has for you. There's a scripture that I've been personally saying and thinking about and pondering, meditating on. It's in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. It says, to know the love of Christ. That word know, it's not like, you know, I know your name, Andy. No. It's, I know you. It's an intimate word. It's like after you've been with someone. In fact, when I studied this out, it actually goes back to the intimacy between a husband and a wife. When it's real intimacy, when it's not just sex, when it's intimacy, when you really know that person, when you've been doing life with that person, you can almost finish their sentences, you've experienced their loyalty, their faithfulness, and it makes you so on the inside. It's to know the love of Christ and the Spirit of God. He's the revealer of that love. He wants to reveal that love for you. It gives you such courage. It gives you such confidence. Listen, when that love is developed, fear has no opportunity to stay. And every single one of us will have our day with fear. Maybe today you're not afraid of something. Maybe today you're okay. But fear will always be there to try to rob you of experiencing the love of God. I believe it's the opposite of love is fear. It's not hate. All right. So now the Holy Spirit, he is the one who actually restores the divine. So let's look at John chapter 1, verse 12. It says, but to all who received him, to all who said, Jesus, you be my Lord, you be my Savior, for all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power. Say power. Power. Come on, do this and say power. Power. Yeah, I want you to get this. Now that word power also means right. He gave the right. The word power also, in the Greek, it's exousia, and it means delegated authority to influence. Delegated authority to influence. That means you're supposed to be in the driver's seat. That means you're supposed to be leading your life through the Holy Spirit, not being led by your life. Okay? He gave power, the right, to become children of God. It's the Holy Spirit who makes you a child of God. Just like in the very beginning when God breathed into man, that Holy Spirit came into man and made him a divine being. Guess what? It's the Holy Spirit again who restores that divine, who comes right back into that human being, making it again divine as it was in the garden. That's the Holy Spirit. He makes you a child of God, gives you this delegated authority to influence. At the moment you make that decision, all of that power becomes resident on the inside of you. The Bible says you actually become a new creature. You're not the same one with some paint on it. No, new. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. That word new, oh, it's such a delicious word. In the Greek, it's kainos, and it literally means brand new, recently made, and watch this, of a superior quality. You mean when you received Christ, you became brand new and of superior quality? Yes. You should feel very good about yourself right now. Superior quality. Superior. Why? Because the divine came in and restored you to your original position. And this is what I'm going to let you know what I struggle with. Okay, so I've received Christ. The divine nature comes on the inside of me. And where does it come? The Holy Spirit again joins to the human spirit. And when you receive Christ, literally, your spirit now looks just like God's. Yeah. I had to wrap my brain around that for a while. But this is the problem. My soul, my mind, will, and emotions doesn't. Did you ever think about that? Okay, now I'm a new creature. I'm superior. But I still have issues. I still get angry. I still lose my temper. I still get jealous. I still want to strangle my kids. Right? I have all this. My emotions are still out of whack. I'm still in chaos. Right? The reason why that is because what's made new is your spirit, but your mind, will, and emotions. Remember how I said in the very beginning how the mind got influenced by a new influence? What is that influence? It's the world around us. So our soul, our mind, will, and emotions, it gets all of this data from the world, observations, associations, teachings, bombards. And I want to put up a slide. I want to show you over a period of time, our soul has all this negative stuff in it. It has shame and discouragement, and it has bitterness and anger and fear, sickness, strife. You know, every single one of us can say, yep, up, yep, 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 right? That, it doesn't get zapped all at once like your spirit. This goes through a process. It's called transformation. It has to be transformed. And what transforms the mind, the will, and the emotions, what transforms it is the helper, the Holy Spirit. He helps us to literally become what we were created to be from the very beginning. Let's look at the next scripture. John chapter 14, verse 16. This is in the Amplified. The Amplified just gives a lot of extra words. And this is what he does. It says, Jesus says this, and we're going to be looking at these scriptures even next week a little bit more. And I'll ask the Father, and he will give you another helper. That word, another, it's really a fun word. It's allos, A-L-L-O-S in the Greek. And, you know, you could just skip over that word, another, but when you dig into it, this is what Jesus was saying. That word literally means he's not exactly the same, but he's one and the same. He's like me. And he will do in my absence what I would do if I were physically present with you. That's what Jesus was saying. And you know why he was saying it? Because he's telling them, I'm going to leave. And they're like going, where are you going? We left everything to Father. What do you mean you're leaving? No. I'm going to send you another helper. He's like me. He's a little different than me, but he's like me. And he's going to do for you what I would do if I were physically present. That's what he was saying. And he's saying, and I'm going to ask the Father, he's going to give you this comforter. And now that word helper, it means comforter, counselor. How many could use some counsel? He's going to help you. He's going to be a strengthener. How many could use some strength? He's going to stand by you. Another name that they call him is the advocate. You think about a lawyer. He's going to go into that court on your behalf. He's going to fight your battles. Jesus is saying, I'm going to ask the Father. He's going to send you a helper. Now, this helper, he's the one that begins to deal with all that negative that's been built up in our mind, will, and in our emotions. Now, how does he do it? We looked at the scripture last week in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It says, be renewed in your mind. Why? By the word of God. be transformed, actually it says, transformed. And in the original language, transformed is where we get the word metamorphosis, where we understand that word based on the caterpillar. That caterpillar crawls, goes into, and begins to form that cocoon, and then all of a sudden he comes out a completely different creature. There is this opportunity for your mind, will, and emotions to be one with God, submitted to God, and at perfect peace, able to just flow with God. And the way that happens is when you're in the Word of God yourself, when you are in the Word in your small groups, it allows the Holy Spirit to take that and begin to weave a transformation cocoon process on your mind, will, and emotions. And in due time, your mind, will, and emotions will begin to literally flow with your new born-again spirit. They become one, even as it was in the garden, where the mind, will, and emotions were in such unity, totally submitted to the Spirit of God. That's where God's trying to get us, to that place where we're just one. We can flow with God. We're not being manipulated and shaped by a world. We're being shaped by God himself through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit revealed. He is the one who makes you divine. You can't do it without him. He is the one who makes you special and makes you in the image of God. Now, I want to put up another slide. This is what the Lord has for you and I. That your soul, I call the divine soul, it's full of forgiveness and patience and kindness and peace, acceptance. You know, I talked to somebody the other day and they said, "Thank you for accepting me." And I went, "That's Jesus. Jesus accepts us. That's what he does. Then there's no strings attached. He loves us, period." So there's this opportunity for the Spirit of God to transform our soul that it becomes this. I'm pretty sure we'd like this better than that other stuff, right? But that's a process, and it's not going to happen without the Word of God. And that's why we encourage people every day, get into your Bibles, and we have a reading plan, and then we have our small groups where you can dig in and allow the Spirit of God to transform you through the Word of God. That's what he uses. That's his cocoon to transform our souls. But you want to know something? What you're hearing today, really, if you really apply it, it really will change your life. And as I was preparing this message, the last point in your worship guide notes, it's don't be robbed. Don't be robbed of the divine. Today, you have a choice. You can live a mundane life, or you can begin to explore this new nature that's within you and see some major things happen in your life. Now, Jesus, he used this parable. We're not going to go through the whole parable. It's called the parable of the sower. And he says in Mark chapter 4, verse 3, he says, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed, and he was scattering the seed. Some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up." And so the disciples are like, "Okay, what do you mean, Jesus? Could you please explain that to me? Like, put it in my language." And so Jesus says, the farmer sows, he explains the parable. He says, the farmer sows the word. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in their heart. This morning, God, through me, because he and I do this together. If you think this is me up here by myself, are you crazy? He just happens to be using my voice to get a word out to you. The Father is sowing a word right now that he made you divine. He made you for purpose. He made you to make a difference. He made you in his image. He's sowing a word. And in that making you divine, he made you with authority, to delegated authority to run your life through his leading, not the leading of the world, to experience the abundant life that he created you to have. Now the Father's sowing that word. And what the enemy wants to do is steal it before you even leave this place. You want to know why? The enemy is not afraid of you giving your life to Christ or becoming a Christian. He's not afraid of that. But he is afraid of you walking like Christ. He's afraid of you finding out, wait a second, I'm not junk. wait a second. He's given me authority and power to help people. Wait a second. I don't just have to take what comes my way. Wait, I don't have to be manipulated any longer. Oh, he doesn't want you to find that out. Because now understand this, okay? The enemy is a spirit being. Spirit beings, they have to have a physical body to express themselves through. They can't do anything in the earth unless there's cooperation by a physical human being. So when we're walking in strife and anger and hateful and mean and all those things, we're using his stuff. He actually has cooperation to be able to move and do things through our lives that we don't really like. So when someone finds out, wait a second, I'm made in the divine. I can be transformed. My mind can be one with the Father. He is so afraid, because then you're going to step into this divine nature and begin telling him what he can't do any longer in your life. And then you begin to take your city and your family and your workplace, and you say, no, I'm here now. The divine showed up. So it's for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And you can go into your workplace and there's all kinds of chaos happening, and you begin to pray in the name of Jesus, and all of a sudden peace comes in that place. You think the enemy wants that? He's a control freak. So I felt so strong that you have an opportunity to take this. Listen, I'm going to say this too. If you walk out of this place and say, I don't want to be transformed, I like my life just the way that it is. You can. Guess what? God will love you. His love for you will not change. But if we don't allow the Holy Spirit to begin that and continue that transformation, listen, I'm still in a transformation process until I see him face to face. If we don't allow that, we miss out. We miss out on destiny. We miss out on living a mediocre life. You don't have to. But the divine life begins first with a surrendering. And this morning I don't want to close the service without giving every one of you an opportunity. Maybe you've been to church. Maybe you've experienced going to services. But the question I ask to you, did you ever ask Jesus into your heart? Did you ever surrender your heart to let the Holy Spirit, the divine one, come and make you new, as the scripture says, all things have been made new. And it says, whoever believes in his name, whoever trusts in him. He's a gentleman. He'll never force himself on anybody. It takes us to first surrender. And then the most powerful thing happens. God literally comes right back. The divine comes right back into that human spirit and creates something brand new. Now, I want to pray with you. So I'd like every head bowed and every eye closed. This is a very powerful moment. If you want to be included in this prayer to receive Jesus, to start a brand new life, becoming that new person, you've never prayed this prayer, you've never done this before, I want to pray with you. Now, if you want to be included in that prayer to be born anew, what I want you to do quickly, just raise your hand. Say, that's me. I want to be born anew. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Bless you back there. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. I see those hands. Bless the Lord. I see that hand. Bless you. And maybe you're here and you're saying, yeah, I did. A long time ago, I committed my life to Christ, but boy, I just ran from him. Stuff happened. Life happened, and I just ran away from him. But I want to be recommitted to him this morning. If that's you, quickly just raise your hand. That's me. I want to come back. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand up there. Bless you. Bless you. God is doing such a work. Miracles right now in souls are happening all through this place. Oh, the Spirit of God, he's just revealing himself this morning in a powerful way. Now, we're going to pray this prayer, and you pray it with all of your heart and allow that miracle of transformation to your spirit to happen this morning. So repeat this after me. Say, Father, in Jesus' name, I ask Jesus to be my Lord, to be my Savior. I surrender my life completely to you. I believe that right now, your Holy Spirit is coming into my heart and making me new. Today, I'm a child of God. Help me to live for you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give God some praise. Let's welcome these new people into the kingdom.